Views and opinions expressed by callers, guests, and hosts do not necessarily reflect those of the Black Talk Radio Network and Black Talk Media Project. Black Talk Radio is new black media for the new millennium.
Tuned in to Black Talk Radio News. My name is Scotty Reed. I'm broadcasting from behind the enemy lines of USA Inc. It is a Tuesday night, January the 9th, 2018, 9 days into the new year. Greetings to you all. Hope that you are in a safe space right now. We have a fast-moving show for you tonight. We have several guests who will be joining us throughout the next 2 hours. Of course, we'll be kicking at three in a row. So if you're a member of BTRCommunity.com and you're following BTR News, and I recommend that you follow us so you can see our show notes. But if you're not a member, join us there. But if you are a member, you can make your music request there. Just post your video there. Make sure it's a good quality video. So we are taking music requests. Shout out to those who are listening to the podcast at a later date. Make sure to share the podcast. You can also find this program and other programs on Black Talk Radio Network on our YouTube channel, which is at Black Talk Radio. Follow us on Twitter at Black Talk Radio. And if you're on Facebook, follow Black Talk Radio Network. So let me just give you a quick introduction of tonight's program. Again, as I stated, we got a lot of people coming on tonight to speak to us about important issues. We'll be hearing from Sister Baruti, who is joining us from Texas to give us some insight into the arrest of Rakem Balogun. I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, but I'm sure somebody will correct me if I am not. But he is reportedly a co-founder of Geronimo Tactical, also associated with Huey P. Newton Gun Club. I do remember doing interviews in the past with some members of that formation. But he is also described as a principal member of Guerrilla Mainframe. Now, all three groups are proponents of the Second Amendment and support citizens' rights to own and possess firearms in the United States in order to combat racist assaults and attacks on the black community. And y'all know on this program and all throughout the network of the stations as well, document the brutality and terrorism that black people face in this country. So we'll get into some of the details of that, find out who this brother is. Again, as I stated in the warm-up for the show, I could not find a federal press release from any other departments involved. So I'm also wondering, did they disappear this brother? So hopefully we'll be able to get some of those questions answered. Then at the top of the hour, 9 o'clock, during our second hour, we'll be talking to Doshon Farad. He'll be joining us again. Y'all know Doshon. You've seen him on, well, they've canceled that show now, Roland Martin's News One Now is, I believe, the name of the news show he had on whatever that cable channel was, TV One, I think it was. So Doshon was on there quite frequently, but he's an independent black journalist, and he travels to Philly. And in Philly, he was in Philly to attend the hearing between Dr. Umar Johnson and the Pennsylvania Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs, whereas the board was alleging that Dr. Johnson was presenting himself as a licensed psychologist, which the doctor denies. Mr. Farad was able to capture video and audio from within the hearing and a press conference outside of the building at the conclusion of the hearing with Dr. Umar Johnson making comments to the public and his supporters. During the last half hour, that'll be the last half hour, joining us will be Mark Clements, of the campaign to end the death penalty. He gave an update early this morning. Shout out to Mark and his peeps up there in Chicago, Illinois. But he gave an update today on the death penalty case involving Rodney Reed. Rodney Reed is a Texas death row inmate from Bastrop County, Texas, and he's currently on death row for the 1996 murder of Stacy Stites, who was 19 at the time, and she was also engaged to Officer Jimmy Fennell at the time of her murder. Legal experts say they believe that Reed was framed and is innocent of murdering the young woman. And we have a report from KXAN out of Texas saying that a judge who oversaw an October hearing of new evidence in the Rodney Reed case has made a recommendation to the Court of Criminal Appeals against Reed getting a new trial. So according to his defense attorney, this is not the end. Says visiting Judge Doug Shaver's recommendation for a decision in favor of the state is an obstacle for Reed's defense. However, Reed's attorney, Bryce Benjet, said it is not a final decision. The appeals court will make the ultimate decision in the coming months. So you can tune in tonight for this news, dialogue, and more on BTR News every Tuesday night. We're live at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time right here on Black Talk Radio Network, one of the few independently publicly run digital radio platforms in the world. I don't think anybody can present more independent voices than our network. We're not always in agreement on everything, but we are in agreement that the United States on a global scale is joined with others to practice racism and slavery, because slavery was never abolished, y'all. So let's go ahead and welcome in our guest. I do believe we have her on the line, Sister Baruti. And Sister Baruti, if you don't mind giving us your name, because you'll help me with my pronunciation. I'm just a North Carolina country boy, and you know, so you'll help us with the African pronunciation of your name. And give us a little background on yourself, and then we'll speak to you about the case. Thank you for joining us again. Absolutely. On BTR News.
Yes, absolutely, and thank you so much for having me on. My name is Kilaika Anayejali Kwa Baruti Shakur. My name means angel who cares for the teachers, and I'm thankful to God. So yeah, it's Kilaika, but a lot of people call me Kila because it can be quite difficult.
Kilaika.
Kilaika. I am a Pan-Africanist, which means that I am a socialist. I do believe with strong conviction that socialism is the answer for African people to be able to organize themselves and to work towards an absolute power to be able to govern ourselves. This comes from an international base, not just subjected to Africans in America, but I think that the dynamic of our liberation is subjected to all of us internationally taking part in the role to achieve it. So this is at the core of my ideological development. So I am a part of a political party, the United States of Africa Revolutionary Party. Because I understand that African people, you know, we have so many different challenges that we face. I try to be able to, you know, deal with those different things. And one of the things that we understand is that the prison industrial slave complex houses many African people. So we also have to answer that question dealing with mass incarceration, the school to prison pipeline, and also the freeing of all of our U.S. held political prisoners and prisoners of war. So understanding that, I'm also the director of an institution inside of the prisons called George Jackson University. And we do a great amount of work in bridging the gap with our people on the inside. Our goal is to transform the criminal mentality into the revolutionary new African mentality. Internationally, I do work with the National Network on Cuba. That is it's an umbrella of over 150 organizations throughout the world who express extreme solidarity with Cuba. We're working very diligently to lift the embargo act that has been placed upon Cuba. So that's just a little bit about myself, but I've been organizing in Dallas, Texas for over 20 years now, and doing so, it brought me into great solidarity with Guerrilla Mainframe, which we'll be able to talk to you about tonight.
Well, thank you for your service. I really appreciate someone who has dedicated some of their time apart, you know, because we have families and we live lives too as revolutionaries. But thank you for your service for the community. I'm sure you wasn't compensated highly for the work that you did, and that's why you did it, because there's a lot of money to do a lot of stuff that's harmful to people, but, you know, not so much support out there for stuff for people that's trying to bring about revolutionary change. So thank you for your service. And so may I address you as Sister Kilaika?
Yes, Kilaika.
Kilaika, Kilaika. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, there you go.
Kilaika, Kilaika. I got it. Yeah. Kilaika. All right, Sister Kilaika. We're here to talk about, am I pronouncing his name correctly, Rakem Balogun?
That's correct.
Okay, so we're here to talk about him tonight, because according to a press release that has been shared on social media, and I follow and have had the brothers associated with the Huey P. Newton Gun Club out of Texas on the program, because I'm a big believer in the philosophy of the Black Panther Party and Huey P. Newton's conclusions on how to deal with the problems. And he definitely was a supporter of people exercising their Second Amendment rights. But of course, all of this was inspired by Malcolm X, who recommended that Black people form gun clubs and rifle clubs. So I'm all about self-defense behind the enemy lines. But there was a press release issued that said that Brother Balogun was arrested by the ATF and the FBI. So I guess it was like a joint task force. So can you tell us who he is? Give us an introduction to who he is, and anything else you would like to speak on?
Yes, absolutely. And at this time, I am the appointed spokesperson for the Free Rakem Balogun Defense Committee. It's so unfortunate that we have to form a whole nother task force, you know, to deal with this situation when we have so many other political prisoners behind the wall. But nonetheless, it has happened, and we definitely want to bring awareness to this situation, because, you know, this injustice that has happened to Rakem, you know, it affects us all. And Rakem Balogun, being a part of Guerrilla Mainframe, has an objective as a party member. In its formation, just like the Black Panther Party, they had a 10-point platform. Guerrilla Mainframe has a 12-point platform. And they do pretty much the same exact thing. You may want to kind of identify it as like intercommunalism, where they organizing for better education. They organize in their community to bring awareness for community health and wellness. They have food and shelter and clothing programs, things of that nature. And that's how they pretty much started. But with the rise of social media, a lot of people started to see these past few years Black people constantly being murdered and slaughtered and killed by law enforcement agents. And I mean, rapid. I mean, you couldn't even blink. And it's still happening. It's still happening. And we know that it's been happening. Those of us who do study revolutionary history and culture and try to promote programs. We already understood that this was an issue, but with social media, it just really, really became rapid. And so that's a good thing. People started to see these images up close. And so people started to try to organize, find out, how do we combat this? How do we deal with this situation? So some people say, okay, we protest. Some people say, you know, we practice self-defense. Some people say we educate people to know their rights. All of these different things. But what Guerrilla Mainframe started to institute inside of their programs, along with their platform, was the community patrol of the police, and also educating and organizing the people to know how to use firearms, because Texas is an open carry state. And so they started to bring awareness to, you know, you do have a right to bear arms. You do have this right. And so they started to go out into the communities, talking to people, you know, showing them how to do hand-to-hand combat training, how to properly disengage a firearm, put it together, break it down, clean it, things of this nature, what to do if you're a young lady, a woman, and an attacker comes for you, how to get them up off of you, everything that you could think of. For self-defense, but particularly we identified our aggressors as law enforcement agents, and we recognize that they do a lot to intimidate oppressed and working class people in our communities. So we wanted to politically educate people and make them aware of how to be confident and have courage in standing up for your rights. And so they instituted those programs doing exactly that.
If I may, I'm sorry, Sister Kilaika, can you hear me? Yeah, if I may interject along the lines of political education. So I believe it was either today or yesterday, I don't know, it was on Twitter, and it was like top trending Law Enforcement Appreciation Day. Donald Trump put his little appreciation out there. And so I just, you know, participated. You mentioned social media, and I said that Law Enforcement Appreciation Day is a farce in a country that's still practicing slavery legally via the 13th Amendment. And we got modern slave catchers out here also dabbling as tax collectors, because that's what they call policing for profit. That's a tax collector. So I just can't get down with appreciation for law enforcement when you enforcing slavery. You're enforcing that 13th Amendment on the oppressed people's network. I mean, on their necks, you know. So I just wanted to interject that. Please continue.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And that's one of the things that we're going to get into, because this case kind of, they were kind of upset with Rakem, because had this strong demeanor, but he had this very strong demeanor that kind of presented ridicule to them, like, they really didn't like him, because when they're mourning their patriots or their servicemen, you know, it's like we, Rakem and others like myself, we stand up and we glorify our people, like Nat Turner and those freedom fighters who stood up against these certain law enforcement agents throughout history and in our current times. And I get into that and tell you why. But yeah, so he was like very strong, and Rakem, he took the leadership with educating on these different things, because he was very, very knowledgeable, and he had a military background in history, and he knew exactly what he was doing. And he was the type of person, no matter where we went, no matter where we go, we felt safe and we felt confident. And so he also practiced healthy eating, different things of this nature, and exercise and stuff. So he was well-rounded in those areas in hand-to-hand combat, military maneuvers and procedures, and he just gave the knowledge that he had to the people to be able to use in their day-to-day living. But what happened was on August, and what I'm about to say to you is based off of the FBI agent who was at the hearing 3 days after Rakem was kidnapped. This agent gave a testimony, and so he reported that on August of 2015, he witnessed Rakem and others. At this time, Rakem was a member of the Huey P. Newton Gun Club. And I do want to make a statement saying that he is no longer a part of that gun club, and he hasn't been for a while, because some reportings are saying that he is a member, but he is not a member of Huey P. Newton Gun Club. So they followed him August 2015 to this demonstration that took place in Austin. And it was a demonstration, not a protest, but a demonstration of the right to bear arms. And they were walking. It was like the European Gun Club, Guerrilla Mainframe, Black Riders, different formations, and individuals who were not armed who just wanted to demonstrate and bring awareness to the right to bear arms. So they said that they witnessed him leading the pack. And in that demonstration, they were shouting out slogans and chants. Two specifically that he mentioned was they were saying things such as oink, oink, bang, bang, and also there's no such thing as a good pig but a dead pig. And so the agent said that these things here, these chants that they were spewing, is what made them want to isolate Rakem and find out more about this guy, because they were not, they had cause for concern with those things. So the public defender, she acknowledged that, well, sir, you do understand that he and others in this country are within their First Amendment right of freedom of speech, right? And he acknowledged that, and the judge also acknowledged it. But he went on to say, well, we decided to follow him for, get this, 2 years, 28 months, 2 years and 4 months. They decided to continue to follow him around. And upon their following, which was not only through physical surveillance outside of his house, outside of his work, back and forth to his training and community activities, they said that they followed his social media. And so this brings me to the point where you were talking about. So they said on his social media, they found that he was posting and glorifying the guy identified as Micah X. Johnson. Bring your attention to the 2016 Dallas police shootings that took place here. Does this sound familiar to you?
Well, actually, they will find the same thing in my timeline. And we talk about social media and the dangers of social media on this network. That's why we established BTR Community. Ever since I established a presence on social media when these things first launched, like in 2007, 2008, that's how long I've been on there. I've always known not to put, and I'm not saying this about anybody, but that people were going to be watching me and what have you. And so, you know, it's a matter of freedom of speech. Anything that he's been alleged to have done thus far that you've mentioned is expression of freedom of speech, because I portrayed Micah X as a patriot. And I'm a veteran. I'm a U.S. military veteran. And Micah X is a U.S. Army veteran. And in his mind, he was actually enforcing the Constitution, you know, and looking out for other people. I mean, so I acknowledge it's a war out there. You got veterans also in the police uniform that shouldn't even be in the uniform because they got PTSD and shell shocked and all of that. So, I mean, it's a matter of perspective. But isn't this what they tell us is so supposed to be so great about this country? I mean, you right. We hear they have holidays for rapist slavers like Thomas Jefferson and George Washington, and they enslave people. And so, you know, that's a matter of First Amendment speech to me. So, yeah, but I remember the person. Yeah. So they will find the same thing. And I'm not going to say, of course, I was careful not to call for any killings or anything, but I didn't condemn him. I was like, well, you know, maybe he was like, hey, I joined that military. I risked my life for some freedom, liberty, and justice for all. And then we come back home and they practicing slavery. I discover these people still practicing slavery. Some people might feel some kind of way. And then seeing all of these murders, how many did they kill in 2017? We reported it the other day. I know it's over 1,200 a year. And it's every classification you could think of. Hell, they killed a Trump supporter last week, but, you know, that's neither here nor there. But please continue.
Right. So this thing they said, well, on his social media, he was giving praise and making it as if this guy was a hero for what happened in Dallas. And we don't like that, is basically what he said. He said Rakem also donned a T-shirt that said 7/7, which commemorated that day. But we noticed that this guy looked at him as some sort of hero. And we see this as a problem. So once again, the public defender stated, well, you know, you do understand that he's within his First Amendment right. She said, within the time frame that you had been following him these past 2 years and 4 months, did you see him on his social media or any other place make threats to kill any officers or any other civilians? Did you see him make any type of threatening outbursts or anything that could bring him to arrest or anything at all? And any criminal activities? And for the 2 years and 4 months, there was nothing. The agent acknowledged that. There was nothing there for them to arrest him for and so forth. So why continue to follow him for this amount of time? So the agent went on to say, so we continued to follow him, and based off of his social media, we found out that he was going to Detroit, Michigan, to do a lecture there. And we followed him, is what he said. And Rakem told us that, you know, he went to the airport, and when he went to the airport, he had a difficult time going through the checkpoint, and so difficult to where he ended up missing his flight. But, you know, he is that guy, you know what I'm saying? We're not unfamiliar with how these people function. So when you have a hard time like that, you already know what it is. However, he didn't know the extent of it as we do today. And so he reported that I lost my luggage. My luggage did not, he had a check on bag. He checked the bag in, and he said that, you know, my luggage didn't make it to Detroit. But, you know, he went on about his merry way and did what he went to Detroit to do, to educate the people. And so upon his return, you know, his lost luggage that he didn't have, he just went through the procedures of reporting it lost. And they returned his luggage to him. Spirit Airlines returned his luggage. Oh, Mr. Rakem, his name is Christopher Daniels. Mr. Daniels, here's your luggage. You know, the proper protocol that an airline uses when they deliver your luggage back to your house. And so no thoughts of it at all. But according to the FBI agent, he said, we followed him to the airport. And when we followed him to the airport, we got his luggage. We got his luggage. We went through his luggage. And inside of his luggage, we found a firearm. And he is in illegal possession of this firearm. Okay, let's say that's the case. Let's say that that's the case, and we deal with that. But any person of logic and reason should ask the question, and I ask the listeners to ask the question with logic and reason, why would they return the luggage back to his house the same way it was with that same firearm on the inside of the luggage, just the way he had packed it. And then issue a warrant for that firearm that was allegedly illegal possession, issue a warrant to be able to kick down his door. 3 weeks later, the warrant was issued to be served on December 7th through the 18th, executed. The 7th through the 18th of December, which was 3 weeks after. They executed the warrant on December 12th, which is well over 3 weeks. So why would you return a firearm to a person who allegedly doesn't supposed to have it? Why now, if you follow him to the airport, why not stop it then? Why not take him into custody then? And the reason being is because, and I have with strong conviction, very strong, and based off of historical analysis, just like they did with Fred Hampton, they wanted to kick that door in at 4 o'clock in the morning so they would be able to kill him. At 4 o'clock in the morning, people are discombobulated. They know that this is a guy who practiced self-defense, you know, protect himself and all of these things. They wanted to kill him when they kicked that door in. However, he did not present that opportunity to them, and it was a very peaceful transition.
Well, but what Sister they also Kilaika, had... I'm going to have to stop you right there as we will take a station identification break. If any of the listeners out there, if y'all have any questions, please be quick about it. You can give us a call at 866-510-9025, 866-510-9025. Hit star to put yourself in the caller's queue. Of course, watch your background noise as we try to preserve the audio quality of the podcast. But most definitely, if you have any questions, how you could lend assistance, we'll get Sister Kilaika to tell us about opportunities for a bail fund and straighten us out on that. And then we do have some questions, and we'll ask those questions on the other side. You're listening to BTR News on the Black Talk Radio Network.
This is a man that's important to world culture. He's a renegade poet, teacher, and scholar.
Don't give a fuck if your crew coming. No one specific speaking, gender by the lieutenants. Blue spinning got your whole damn crew sending two lemons in my water glass in my suit linen. Means I stay winning. You lukewarm, I shot for them, got you open like loose women. Is you kidding? Never bit, but I've been bitten. Truth always been hitting. Chain fake, MC's been fibbing. Better know your limits. Got a cannon, is you photogenic? Obituary with the photo in it. Call that a photo finish. Crazy how I hold the clock. Chest gone, head missing. Body looking Photoshop. Body bad, tell him op. Listen to the stories told. Wheels like a can of pop. Girl like a totem pole. She ain't got a kiss and toe. Tell her where to find a king. Never on BET. Hardly in the movie screen. Since an infant, rapping was instant. Two sticks and incense. Candy was 10 cent. I aim with intent. I sin and repent. Then sin and repent. That cycle begins like wash and then rinse. Must mention my gift and lyrics intertwined with intervention. Please get off my Jimmy. Henchman. No IV. Hip hop need an IV. All these one hit wonders turn to wide knees. Funny ass swag like bass and YB. Never based on anything real, you're not me. You want to kick it? Tai Chi paid me a pair of Uggs to you for G's. Not talking boots though. Russian shooter even Jordan needed Q coach. Came off the bench like put me in for you coach. All these new rappers nothing short of glucose. Sucio, Puto, got old money in the
jeans and my Ferris suit cap. And you know I stay on my grind, hitting loopholes. I'm Shaq, you a new bro. D1, you Juco. I'm Mr. Miyagi, Danny LaRusso. Too slow to keep up, too soft to speak up. Nervous around me like weed head and pizza. Ride on your V up, smashing your V up. Just to get a pass in the hood to bring me up. But I'm a soldier, never did amnesia. I am who I say that I am, you amnesia. Fam, if you plan to go ham, can't feed you. My flow be the bubonic plague, you spitting fever. Help. Huh? Oh. Could deal our teeth. Help.
Okay, Cole, this is getting warm, man.
To introduce myself, check my feet. Straight from the sewer, playing truth to the street.
Why, oh why, must I try to explain?
Next level, I got
to have it. Acknowledge the fact that you be rap.
Next level, I got to have
it. The intricacy, call clicks, levels, right into
top. Next level, I got to have it.
You are tuned in to Black Talk Radio News. Scotty Reed in on this broadcast behind these enemy lines that I call USA Inc. Check the 13th Amendment. They still practicing slavery. Slavery was never abolished. That's not mass incarceration, you see. That's slavery. That, call it what they call it. Involuntary servitude and slavery as punishment for quote-unquote crime. And as soon as you come to that realization, perhaps you will follow the footsteps of the abolitionists of the 1860s. And we know how that turned out. So, we have a guest. We got Sister Kilaika on the line with us. And if you have any questions, we have her on for about maybe 10, 15 more minutes. So she'll give us that information where we can donate at to his defense funds and also answer some questions. Sister Kilaika, I got a question. If you can clear this up for me. Because I couldn't find an arrest for him at all. And I checked the ATF. I checked the FBI press release. I checked the Dallas is in the Northern District of the Department of Justice. And so you mentioned earlier that his name is Christopher Daniels, so that might have contributed to why I couldn't find a press release, because I'm thinking that they didn't rendition this person. Why can't I find any kind of press release to confirm? Because then we would need people at the Human Rights Network to do what they call a habeas corpus, and you had to produce this person. So can the information is just kind of spotty out there. So can you clear some of that up for me?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there may have been the difficulty that you had with finding, because his name is Christopher Daniels, and we need as much support on the situation as possible. So I do have the first court hearing and the case docket and all of that information that I would love to share with you, and you can disseminate it throughout your networks. Also have the press release that we did when we first, when it first came to light and what we had to do and how we needed to address this. So I'd be happy to share those things with you. All of this, we're trying to be as transparent as possible because we do need the support of the people. Because what I left off with this suitcase being delivered back to him, well, in the hearing, like the FBI agent said, they followed him to the airport. But our lawyer just let us know that the story is that the airlines called them to the airport. They called them to the airport. So if that was the case, then why wouldn't you, arrest him? But nonetheless, it's a contradicting
story. Well, I have a
story,
question about that. Sister Kilaika, I have a question about that. So the way that I understand airports to work, you got all of this billions. I don't know what the budget of the TSA is, but for a person to put a gun in a suitcase, now it was my understanding that they scan everything, and so I don't understand how they would give him possession of the suitcase. You know what I'm saying? It seemed like I don't understand. I mean, did he check out with the suitcase? Did they allow him to leave with the suitcase? What's going on there?
Well, yeah, that's the thing. The suitcase, he had to report it lost, because when he finally made it through TSA after being heckled, he finally made it through the checkpoint. But when he got to Detroit, his suitcase was not with him. So he just went through the standard procedure of claiming lost luggage.
So why they didn't arrest him?
The airlines delivered it to him with an apology.
Yeah, so again, that sounded like to me somebody had plenty of opportunity to plant some evidence, and we read stories about those all the time on New Abolitionist Radio every Wednesday and discuss them. So, you know, people should understand that we're dealing with a corrupt entity. So please continue.
And I do want to make it short, because it is quite a bit of detail, but the message that we're trying to convey to the people is that this, what has happened to Rakem, is something that affects us all, because as we are organizing in our communities, grassroots organizing, they're noticing and they're seeing our potential. And our very potential is a threat to capitalism. Our very potential is a threat to U.S. imperialism. The people are the ones who will change everything. And when the people become empowered to dismantle this modern day prison slavery, this slavery that exists, I mean, and to confront all of the things that are needed to be confronted, you know, they get weary, they get shaky, they try to stop it at every point. And so what has transpired is just like COINTELPRO. COINTELPRO was a operation that they had that wasn't, you know, public information, but nonetheless, as they went through their procedures and their protocols and they dismantled certain movements, this is the same thing that they're trying to do. So this classification, we want to bring awareness to organizers, particularly organizers. They are trying to classify people like
us. So you're
talking
about BIE,
and they have this
right.
thing they call Black Identity Extremists.
Right.
It's a classification that identifies individuals who are anti-police. You know, and it's not just anti-police, but I want to make it clear, we are anti-pigs. We are anti-pigism. A pig is a law enforcement agent that terrorizes the people, that tries to enforce their authority upon the people and use intimidation tactics and murder and slaughter, as we have seen. And that's a large number. So they were mad at Chris for saying there's no such thing as a good pig. And we need to stand firmly and keep continuing to say and identifying these pigs. They're pigs, pigs, pigs. It's important for us to identify them, because they are terrorizing our people, and they want to keep our people afraid. And so them snatching him up was an intimidation tactic for us organizers. Now, there was a report today on YouTube, this news called Advice News. There was a black guy, he did a story, and he got quite a bit of views on this particular thing.
I watched some.
And he did a pretty good job. But what he did at the end, which was really disheartening, he said that we need to change up our strategies. We need to be a little bit softer. He said, instead of wearing fatigues and looking militant, put on a suit like me. Put on a suit and tie. You know, look more European is what he was saying. So is that you don't be so looked at, and it'll be hard to identify you. But let me tell you something. The African plight for organization and liberation is always going to be under investigation. And I don't care if you got fatigues on. I don't care if you got on a dashiki. Whatever you got on, you cannot have on nothing at all. But when you are working to organize the people, you are always going to be a threat to this very system. And so if the answer is not to look more European and to stay under the radar, we need to come up from under the radar. Now, you do have underground operations. You have above ground. But the people are the makers of history. The people are the ones that can change things. And so we got to be where the people are and give them the proper tools and education that they're needed to organize themselves. You cannot do that in hiding. You cannot do that by trying to appease your oppressor. You cannot make things comfortable for your oppressor.
If I may add and interject there. Okay, so I'm former military as well, so I'm also an objective journalist, and I've been doing this for the people since 2007. That's why we set up Black Talk Radio Network to combat the slavers' grip on media and on people's minds. As Malcolm X said, media controls the minds of the masses. Now, I understand the part about being more covert. What I mean by that is there are certain operations that you shouldn't be afraid of, and you should be very public about it, just like this platform is a public media organization with public radio, uncensored, not corporate sponsored, nobody censoring us. People donate, it's people powered to keep this information outlet. So I'm out front with that. But if I was part of other formations where I am organizing rifle clubs, let's just call it, all these white people have all these militias. Ted Bundy keeps getting off. They're not convicted Ted Bundy of anything. And so we have all these militias, and people would be fools not to organize on that level. But what I would say, though, is we have to use technology in a smart way, in that we don't organize on Mark Zuckerberg's platform or any of the white people that run Twitter, and that some of our stuff need to be like 18, like the TV series 18, underground, straight up underground, but still organizing. Now, you can organize by setting up your own social media, setting up your own virtual private server, where, you know, we're getting technical now to where, but that's just, so I understand that, but this stuff about putting on a suit and all of that, they're looking at your skin, they're looking at your economic conditions, and they're seeing them dollar signs and how much you're going to make as a slave, and if you resist, you could end up a dead slave. So I disagree with him on that. I did not watch it all the way to the end. I thought it was rather kind of long, but he did do a good job of reporting in his way, you know, some of the facts of the case. But I do agree with you that you cannot be looking to integrate, because we're talking like a pig culture, like you said. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I have put out there, I don't see color when it comes to police. I call them slave catchers. Other people call them pigs. People got acronyms for them and what they do. So I call them slave catchers. And so some people take offense to that. But so, you know, definitely I support free speech, but I do agree with some of our formations need to be more covert. But then again, they can infiltrate. You mentioned COINTELPRO, so let's not even sleep that we're not going to have face-to-face infiltrators. And so we just need to get tight on our security. But sister,
yeah, everything has last to be 10 tight minutes. And that's where organization comes in.
Right.
You know,
right.
The level of organization and how you organize, because just like this platform, like you do journalism, we need journalists. You know what I'm saying? We need journalists. We need secretaries. We need doctors. We need lawyers. We need scientists. We need engineers. And we need military operations. You know, what is our collective objective? You know, we have to answer that. And when we talk about our collective objective, the bottom line is they don't want it to happen. Because if you understand capitalism, the very foundation of capitalism is for us to stay oppressed. And if any time we're trying to eradicate that, and I don't care what method you're using, they're going to come for you. But that doesn't mean you stop what you're doing. But absolutely, let's be strategic. Let's be tactical. Let's be practical in our collective efforts. Absolutely. But yes, he did a great job, but it was just that very thing when he said, put on a suit like me. Oh, that just really just sent chills to my body, like, no, bruh, But nonetheless, moving on, there are a lot of things that we need support in. But again, the main thing is we want African people to be free. We want to end prison slavery. We want African people to be free all the way around. And so we are asking people to talk about this very thing because it brings awareness that this attack is constant. This attack, the very same strategies and tactics that they were using then, they're still using it now. And we need people to be aware. Guerrilla Mainframe has a huge potential to set and build institutions across this nation. And they saw that. And they feared that. And we know that there are other people that are organizing out there that have the very same potential, and they don't want it. So we need people to amp up their programs. We need people to get serious about revolutionary work. And that's our main message with this. It's time to truly get serious, not just doing it in your leisure or when you have the spare time. Make it a top priority. And this is what Rakim wants. He wants us to make this top priority, our programs and so forth. But as far as his freedom is concerned, it is primary as well. And we are in need of legal representation. We do have a lawyer at this time. But those things come with cost. And so we do have a legal defense fund that people can donate to. Like we have this PayPal me, if you go to www.paypalme/GMF214, you can find it. And then we have the Cash App with the $GMF214. So these are the ways that people can donate. Not only do we need money, but we need bloggers, we need journalists, we need writers, we need people to do letter writing campaigns, not just for Rakim, but bringing awareness to all of our U.S. held political prisoners. We need people to organize in their communities. We need to come to your communities. We need to talk about this. You know, whatever expertise you have, you may be a videographer, you may be a photographer, come to our city. We come to your city. Let's work together.
Well, Sister Kilaika, I want to thank you again. And if you would forward me that information so that I could disseminate that to our peeps inside of btrcommunity.com, which is the social media platform for this radio network. And definitely keep us in the list, the email list for any future press release. So, again, does he have a scheduled hearing? When is that? Because public support turning out to these hearings and what have you are important in that regard as well. So when is that?
Yes. He had the first hearing on December 12th, but it should go in front of a grand jury, like to see if it's going to get indicted on by the 15th, they said. I've already said by the 15th, which is coming up, to find out if it's going to be an indictment or not. See, what they're doing is they have that charge, but they're not dealing with the charge. He has no bond, and they're holding him because they said for probable cause he's a danger to the community. So it's not so much about the charge. It's like this whole umbrella that they were trying to place him up under, this classification, is what we've been dealing with.
Strip him of his rights. As far as the charge itself,
it's supposed to go up in front of the grand jury to see if there's going to be indictment by the 15th. But one thing that I do want to say is I'm also going to send you his address so you can write him and stay in touch with him. And I want to tell people this. Rakim is currently inside of the prison, but just like our comrade George Jackson, you know, just like Katari Golden, just like W.L. Nolan, just like all of our people who organize inside the prison, he's in there with our brothers, training with them. He's giving them political education. He's doing all these things that he was doing on the outside. And he wrote us a letter, and he let us know that. And he was like, man, we got these brothers in here. They work, you know, they working out We're studying George, we're doing this, we're doing that. And so he's a threat out here and he's a threat in there, you know, because it's just as worse in there. They don't want the brothers in there to be politically educated. But nonetheless, he's still on that very same mission, and we're very proud of him for doing that. We didn't see anything other than that. He wouldn't be doing anything other than that, but I do want to make mention that he is still on the same road towards African liberation and working with his people on the inside, and we salute him for that.
And I want to thank you for sharing his story, and of course you will be doing a follow-up on this story. Again, we're talking about, and if you would, you said I should be searching for his name, his government name, if you could give that to us one more time. Sister Kilaika. Sister Kilaika, you
said his name Christopher
Daniels. Christopher, yes. Daniels. All right, that'll help us, you know, in terms of people being able to make some moves legally. All right, thank you again, sis. You have a great night, and stay safe behind these enemy lines.
Oh, thank you, too. Good night.
Good night. All right, you are tuned in to BTR News. In just about 5 minutes, we should be talking to Doshon Farad. Maybe 5 minutes or 10 minutes after the hour. I'm going to text him up. And when we come back, he's going to talk to us about the hearing that he attended in Pennsylvania. I believe it was on Monday, on the 8th, which was yesterday. The hearing where the Pennsylvania Board of Professional and Occupational, whatever their title is, had a hearing and alleging that Dr. Umar Johnson was practicing psychology without a license. Now, the ramifications, if found guilty of that, is that you won't be able to get your license. And Dr. Umar said he doesn't practice psychology. He doesn't have an outside practice. He practices within the Pennsylvania school system under the supervision of a licensed psychologist. So that came out in the hearing. We posted what Doshon videotaped. Again, Doshon Farad, independent black journalist. You may have seen him on Roland Martin's program in the past. That program has been canceled. But Doshon's still doing his thing, so he provided us with that news report, that video report, and the audio wasn't the best. I'm surprised he was able to get that footage in that proceeding, but that wasn't a criminal court proceeding. It was a civil board meeting, so maybe, you know, they allow that kind of stuff. But very interesting, and we'll get some of the facts from him. Being that we really need more background about what occurred and what's the next process in this step, and we'll get that from him in just a bit. All right, before we go to our three in a row break, it's time to take a three in a row break. Again, I'm still battling the weather related illnesses, kind of losing my voice, but we got a call from area code 347. Thank you for calling in to BTR News. Give us your name and go ahead with your question or comment.
Hey, Scott. What's up, Thomas? How you doing, bro?
I'm doing best I can, Thomas. How are you tonight?
I hear you, brother. I just wanted to say, man, did you see this report? Northern Nevada teen sued over alleged racial bullying in school. It was in the Las Vegas Review Journal. But these two teenagers were being racially bullied for some time, and finally they had enough, so their parents pulled them out of school and sued the school board. So I thought that was interesting. And that was the only thing I wanted to report, Scott. All right. I want to know if you heard anything about that.
No, I had not. I had not. Usually Ross and them was good about posting a lot of different news stories in btrcommunity.com, and I had not seen it come across the mainstream so-called Google News feed or what. So, no, I had not, but we'll definitely look into it. perhaps if some of our listeners or members of BTRcommunity.com, if y'all got a link, y'all could post that story. All right. All right. So thank you, Thomas. We're going to go into a music break, and I'm just coordinate the time and see if we can get Mr. Farad on. But you're listening to Black Talk Radio News. My name is Scotty Reed. I broadcast this program live every Tuesday night at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern time. That is concrete. You can put it in the calendar and ink pen. I'm coming on, God willing, on Tuesday nights at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern time with 2 hours of news, music, dialogue, information, guests. Don't forget, later on, we'll also be talking to Mark Clements, trying to end the death penalty, but he'll be giving us an update on the case of Rodney Reed, brother on death penalty for killing a 19-year-old white woman back in 1996. Many advocates and criminal justice advocates who have looked at the evidence of the case and have been trying to get Mr. Reed a new case said that all evidence seems to point towards her boyfriend at the time, who was a slave catcher. So we'll be coming at you with that and more on the other side. Keep it locked right here on Black Talk Radio Network. The Black Talk Media Project launched the digital radio platform Black Talk Radio Network, the first such platform created to serve the black community specifically. Black Talk Radio Network has grown with a variety of radio hosts, digital radio stations, and podcasters. Web analytics say Black Talk Radio, the platform, has an online reach that ranks it among the top independent black media platforms in the world. All of this is possible because of financial contributions to the nonprofit Black Talk Media Project. If you love the work we do and the voices and perspectives we bring to you every day, make a donation today to ensure that Black Talk Radio is here in the future. Black Talk Radio is new black media for the new millennium.
Playback.
Your heart, cause I know you got a soul. Listen, if you're missing, y'all, swinging while I'm singing. Give it what you're getting, knowing what I'm knowing. While the black band's sweating in the rhythm I'm rolling. Gotta give us what we want, gotta give us what we need. Our freedom of speech is freedom of death. We got to fight the power, stop beat. Fight the power. Fight the power. Fight the power.
As the rhythm's designed to bounce with health and mental life, designed to fill your mind now that you realize the prize arrives. We got the pump to start to make it tough. From the heart, it's the start of work of art to revolutionize, make a change, up and trade.
People,
we are the same, no we're not the same, cause we don't know the game. What we need is awareness, we can't get careless. You say, what is this?
Yeah.
I love it, let's get down to business. Mental self-defense or fitness.
Fight the power,
fight the power.
simple and plain.
Motherfucking ninja, I'm Wayne.
Cause I'm black and I'm proud. I'm ready to hype cause I'm amped. Most of my heroes don't appear in no stamp. Sample, look back, you looking fine. Nothing but rednecks for 400 years of you tech.
Don't worry, be happy.
Was a number one fan. Damn if I said you could spot me right here. Hit it.
Now get this part.
And welcome back to Black Talk Radio News. Scotty Reed in on this broadcast from behind the enemy lines of USA Inc. As we come on the other side of 9 o'clock, it is 9:05 p.m. Eastern Time. Thank you for tuning in. And make sure you tell other people about Black Talk Radio. Find us online at blacktalkradionetwork.com. Of course, the platform adapts to any kind of device that you're on. You can listen into. People ask me, do you need an app? No, you don't need no app. The platform adapts to your smartphones, to your tablets, and you'll be able to tune in to all the content. So check us out. Bookmark us. Get a subscription, free subscription. Register right there on the site, blacktalkradionetwork.com. So, we are about to speak to independent journalist Doshon Farad, a reporter who has participated in panel discussions with Roland Martin, whose News One program was canceled despite decent ratings. Mr. Farad traveled to Philadelphia to attend a hearing at the Pennsylvania Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs, whereas the board was alleging that Dr. Umar Johnson was presenting himself as a licensed psychologist, which the doctor denies. Mr. Farad was able to capture video and audio from within the hearing and a press conference that took place outside of the building at the conclusion of the hearing. So we want to welcome on back on to Black Talk Radio News, I should say, Brother Doshon Farad. Greetings to you. Thank you for joining us tonight, Brother Doshon.
Thank you for having me, my friend. Brother Scotty, it's always a pleasure joining the Black Talk Radio Network.
All right. So, Doshon, first, before we get into this report out of Philadelphia that you filed, what's going on with News One, man? What's going on with the cancellation of that program?
Well, Scotty, just to let you know, it wasn't News One that got rid of Roland's program. It was TV One.
Yes, TV One. Thank you for the correction.
TV One and News One are two different entities.
Yeah, what was the name of Roland's show? It was News One Now, or what was it
called? Right, it was called News One Now. It was News One Now. Right. They were affiliated with each other, but what happened was in 2015, Russell Simmons had acquired or bought the website News One, although it still stayed affiliated with TV One. So let's be very clear. It wasn't News One Now, or News1.com, and TV One are owned by two different people, although they're still affiliated with each other. The situation was, the reason that they had gave that news, that excuse me, that TV One had gave, that the show was being cut due, being canceled due to budget cuts. Now, here's the thing. what got people so concerned is that in September, keep in mind, News One Now had went on the air in 2013, and it was an excellent show. We'll come on at 8 o'clock a.m. It did so good in the ratings that they moved it to 7 o'clock a.m. They figured that it could compete with the other news shows on CNN and MSNBC, et cetera, et cetera. And then the show had did so well after that that in September they had extended it to 2 hours from 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. So it had a lot of eyebrows that were raised. Now keep in mind, now people are wondering, why would you cancel the only national daily news show dealing with black folks' issues? And which takes me to another issue. It's sad that Roland had the only show like that. There should be many shows, many black hosted shows dealing with black issues. Many people felt that it was canceled at a bad time. Because they now concerning budget cuts, people are saying, well, wait a minute, if you don't have enough money to keep on our only national daily black news show, why is it that you kept Sister Circle, which is a talk show that's on, but it's the closest that TV1 has the news, and it's actually the only, keep in mind, TV1 is black owned, you know, so it was started by Kathy Hughes, and it's ran by her son, Alfred Liggins.
Right.
Hello?
So, yes,
oh, yes, sir.
Yes, we have you, because I saw Roland, because I was questioning whether or not black people were supporting his program. Like you mentioned, it was the only black program with a black panel, with a black host, on the black-owned network, discussing black issues, and had more leeway than I would say on those other corporate networks to speak directly to black people's issue. You know, they still, I feel like, still had that corporate muzzle because it is a business, and she didn't start no nonprofit, and so they do. But Roland had came back and corrected, you know, that rumor that was like, hey, it wasn't because of ratings, so I guess black people was tuning in to his program. And he said it wasn't because of that, because we were doing well in our time slot. So, I mean, Doshon, you know, I understand you are in that industry, so I don't know if you can speak clearly to what you think, what really went on, you know what I'm saying?
Well, like I said, TV1 said from the beginning that it was due to budget cuts. Now, you have other people that say that it might have been something else. There might have been something that Roland, perhaps, there's a TV1 insider who I know who would choose to remain nameless, who had stated that Roland had upset some people in people higher ups at TV1. And that was the budget cuts was just an excuse, as I was told. But I have not been able to substantiate that. The only person we were able to speak with at this point would be Roland concerning that. But that's, you know, Roland didn't mention it.
Understood.
You know, he said the reason they gave him on their press release when the day that they announced it, which, you know, they had actually, as soon as Roland went off the air that day, and you know, that early December, that's when, you know, he was at a staff meeting, and that's when they said, oh, by the way, we're cutting your show, you know, like that, we're canceling your show. So the only one who would know for sure who's lying, who's telling the truth, would be Roland.
Well, Doshon, one last question.
And the people that canceled him. And just to let you know, Roland wasn't fired from TV1. He's still on contract with TV1 until August of this year. So keep in mind.
Yeah, so they got to pay
working.
Him.
He's not ruined. And he's also still with Tom Joyner. He's still doing the commentaries of Tom Joyner. And the company that Tom Joyner runs is owned by Miss Hughes as well.
Okay, so listen, I had seen on Twitter or something, called Roland Martin Does Twitter, and so I had seen a post where he was saying, like, and he already has some of his own media under his own name and brand already established. He has a couple of, so has he expressed to you, or had you read anything that he's going to pursue that independent, as an independent? And another follow-up question to that, Doshon, I've never understood why I see like people like Goldie Moore, Melissa Harris-Perry, whoever it is that gets dismissed from the corporate news media plantation. I don't understand, with their huge followings that they have on social media, of them not coming together, even in a for-profit manner in creating, you know, a digital only, video only. I don't care if they threw it up on YouTube. You know what I'm saying? You can,
yes,
you know,
sir.
I don't understand why they don't do that. And so please, what is Roland going to do? Is he going to pursue that?
Well, keep in mind, Roland was already hosting a live stream broadcast along with his show. But what Roland had launched several months ago, before he had got canceled, he has what's called All That TV. And he still does what he does, just like what I do. He does the live stream broadcast, the live stream interviews. So he had already been doing this for quite some time. So that right there, he started that, like I said, months. This is like literally, All That TV may have been started last spring, I believe. He sent out a press release saying that he started All That TV. So he's doing that now. Now, consider the rest of the folks that you mentioned, some of the people that were fired or, sat down, fired, et cetera, et cetera. Keep in mind that a lot of us, those of us who will be classified as black, we don't have an independent mindset, a lot of us, okay? But there are also several reasons that go into us not putting stuff together. But you're right. We should be going using new media. And that's one of the reasons why I said when it was announced that Roland's show got canceled, Brother Scotty, I got annoyed. And if you might remember, I mentioned you, and I said, what are you all talking about when people were saying, oh, my God, black media is dead, black news is gone? I said, what are you talking about? You have me. You have Michael Imhotep. You have yourself, the Black Talk Radio Network. I said, you have all these, I was naming people who have YouTube shows and online platforms. You cannot place black media on the shoulders of just one person. I respected Roland tremendously. I loved his show. But at the same time, as I said earlier in the broadcast, there should be many national TV shows, okay, black TV shows as it once was, okay, in the 90s and early 2000s. We should have several national shows dealing with black issues hosted by black people and owned and supported by black people. So keep in mind, there are a lot of factors why someone like a Melissa Harris Perry may not want to start their own online platform. But keep in mind, you also have Russell Simmons. Russell Simmons has started, Deaf Media, All Deaf Digital, and he started different divisions of it. One of them was All Deaf Digital America. He started an online news platform. Puffett started that. P. Diddy started Revolt Television, online news platform. So you have many of us, or a few of us, who are doing it. They're just not getting the press. They're not getting the attention.
Okay. Well, Doshon, we have about 10 minutes left with you. When you attended the hearing that, let me make sure I put the information. There was a hearing at the Pennsylvania Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs, whereas the Board of Psychology, whatever regulates and licensed psychologists in the state of Pennsylvania, alleged at this hearing that Dr. Umar Johnson had been presenting himself as a licensed psychologist, which Dr. Johnson denied. And so, So is that correct? Is that what the nature of the hearing was for?
Yes.
Okay, could you speak
on
that?
Well, keep in mind, there were several complaints about Dr. Johnson's, there were concerns and complaints about the role that he was playing regarding his practice, regarding his profession. One of the people that went to him, that told on him, I just interviewed her, as a matter of fact, on Sunday night, Marjorie Tabb, who's a woman educator, I believe. She said that she's been involved in having to investigate other people's credentials. She's another YouTube or media personality who goes by the name of Miss Justice. She's one of the people that openly, she straight up said, as soon as Dr. Johnson had announced that the state required him to show up for a hearing, she went on Facebook and said, yes, I'm one of the coons that told on Umar Johnson. Now, keep in mind, and to your listeners, regardless of, I want to be clear to your listeners, I'm not here to be a cheerleader for Umar Johnson, but I have to state the actual facts, okay? The issue was not if he was lying about having a doctorate degree, which he does have a doctorate degree. I was one of the first people to find his dissertation, like going back maybe three, 4 years ago. He does have a doctorate degree. He got it from one of the schools in Philadelphia, and I forgot the name of it. You have to go to his website, but I forgot the name of it. But anyway, just to let you know, throughout the whole hearing, it wasn't a trial, it was a hearing, the woman who presided somewhat like a judge. She wasn't a judge, but she was like a hearing officer. That was her title. And the prosecutor, they actually did have an actual prosecutor, although it wasn't a trial.
It was like an arbitrator is what I would say her role is. Like, yeah, so she was an arbitrator. Right. And then these are like civil, civil proceedings.
You say like an arbitrator, but her title was hearing officer, okay?
Right,
presiding,
right.
She's a hearing officer.
So is she the one who will make the determination, Brother Doshon?
No. No, she doesn't do the determination. It's the board. What happened was none of the board members had showed up. They didn't have to show up. What happens is she presides over the case. She listens to the arguments, okay? She listens to both sides, and then she makes a recommendation. She brings it to the board, but the board has to read the proceedings of the hearing.
I got you. Yeah, but let me say this, Doshon, because there's a lot of stuff that has been said about
Dr. Johnson. But I have to make clear.
No, Scott,
I have to make clear, though, but this is what I wanted to say, brother, briefly. Yeah. The woman that presided over the hearing and the gentleman who was the prosecutor, they both kept referring to Umar Johnson as Dr. Johnson.
Right.
Just let you know that.
I want to make that clear, too, because there are people out there and stuff has been put out by the Roots saying that Umar Johnson isn't his name. But that's what's on the motion for the hearing. You know,
he changed it legally. He changed his name legally. Yeah. It was Jermaine, and he said that. I mean, saying it's not his name. No, he changed his name legally. Right. Just like I changed my last name legally. He was born Jermaine Johnson. He'd tell people that all the time. He changed it legally. He grew up Muslim.
Right.
Okay, he did what a lot of Muslims do. You know, he changed it legally when he was younger.
Right, because also in his picture in the college, I don't have the name, in the yearbook, it is a picture of him. And it does say Umar Johnson. So that is his legal name. And as you pointed out, he is a doctor. They did refer to him as Dr. Johnson throughout. So he is a doctor. So what is that issue? What was the allegations? Was that he was practicing without a license?
They said he was practicing clinical psychology without a license. Now, keep in mind, Dr. Johnson has stated several times in every interview, first of all, they played clips from the Breakfast Club and one from a radio broadcast, Detroit radio broadcast, trying to prove that he was calling himself, that he was trying to mislead people by saying that he was a psychologist. Here's the thing. He has a certificate. He's a certified school psychologist, and he's admitted that, okay, where he's able to if I'm using the term correctly, either diagnose or evaluate children. They said that he was operating a private practice as a clinical psychologist treating adults, which he said that he was not. So what they were trying to say was his accusers is that he was going around masquerading as a clinical psychologist. By their point was they saying, okay, well, unless you are a clinical psychologist, you don't have a right to call yourself a psychologist. You have to say school psychologist. So they were trying to place, they were accusing him of using semantics, but they could be accused of using semantics as well. So what Dr. Johnson had explained during the proceedings, he said, look, if I'm speaking to you in a conversation or if I'm on air, I can't keep saying 100 times, and I'm paraphrasing, of course, as a school psychologist, you know, he said for short, he would refer to himself as a psychologist, but in the beginning of every broadcast, every interview, he would clarify, I am a school certified psychologist.
He did that on Roland Martin's show. I remember he did that in the beginning on the intro and what have you. So I don't listen to a whole lot of Breakfast Club and all of that. I'm not really into the programming that they pushing out to the people. But I did hear in the video that you recorded, they were playing different audio clips and what have you. So what happens now? What happens?
Well, he has to wait 30 days, about 30 days at most. It could be sooner, 30 days at most before the board makes their decision. If anything, the worst that could happen is he'll be fined $10,000, and I believe he may not be allowed, say if he decides to apply for a license, it'll be difficult. Either he won't be able to apply for one, or it'll be difficult for him to get one. It's already difficult anyway. But from what we were told, from what Dr. Johnson said, he's not really interested in getting that a clinical license, from what we were told anyways.
Okay,
he's not worried about that. That, according to him, he's saying that was never his goal. I'm not saying he's saying it was never his goal, but that's not a priority right now. That's what he's saying. And I'm paraphrasing, of course.
Well, Brother Doshon, we got a call from one of our listeners. We have Otis on the line. Do you mind taking a call or a question or two from Otis?
Oh, definitely. Not at all. But just to be clear, like I said, I'm not here you know, whether I'm just to let you know, brother, this is not an issue about the school, about him lying, about, okay, whether he's a fraud or not. Let's just say Dr. Johnson is a fraud.
We're talking about the
hearing.
That
is not what the hearing was about yesterday. It wasn't about whether or not he was a fraud in terms of his school.
You were invited. I'm not here to BTR News under the premise to give us a field report from the hearing that you attended. That's what I contacted you and invited you on the program.
Yeah, I know you didn't know, Scotty. That wasn't for you, brother Scotty. Me and you know each other, brother.
No, just to let everybody else don't know. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yes, sir.
Yeah, just let everybody else know. So, Otis, thank you for calling in to BTR News. You got a question or a comment for Brother Doshon?
Yeah, good evening to both. For quite a while. I just want to make one interjection here. A lot of people say Diddy owns this, so and so owns. I've been tracking a lot of this communication owned by black people for about 8 or 9 years. And I first have one. And I'm going to tell you all again, most of these supposed to be black formats, other than Kathy Hughes, are all agreements done by either Discovery or the big six players in telecommunications because of a lawsuit brought by Byron Allen. I put up a little bit in your chat room so you could read it. I don't want it to eat up a lot of your time. But most of this is Comcast, Verizon, and AT&T trying to use net neutrality rules, break up of what I was in back in the 80s, telecommunications act. They are being sued for not giving black people channels to control distribution. So when you see someone like Diddy say, I own Revolt. No, you don't. He did the very same thing Oprah did with Discovery. It's a 50-50 partnership sold to the old ownership, and it's not true. And I think if you gentlemen actually look at some of the stuff that I send y'all, you'll see what I'm getting to. This is a way to stop what Scotty is doing and what I think you, Doshon, are trying to do. You're trying
Thank
to get
brother.
Black-owned communications from the ground up where you control everything. And I'm
yes,
telling
sir.
You, these people like Diddy are being used as showcase and scapegoats to stop you from getting control of the complete transmission of your data. And I think if you look into Byron Allen's lawsuit, you'll find out I'm not far off. I was in telecommunications when they broke up Marbell. And I love your work. I'll leave it at that.
All right. Thank you, Otis. And I'm, of course, I'm very knowledgeable on 1996 Telecommunications Act. We even talk about it in our mission statement of, or one of our fundraisers on blacktalkmediaproject.org, in a tremendous harm that Clinton bill. It was, again, Democrats and Republicans working together to destroy information channels for black people. And that started in 1996. And it recently got worse under Ajit Pai. I understand now, Brother Doshon, that corporations can even purchase even more stations in
yes.
one market.
Yes. Yes. Because, see, and the funny thing is, Brother Scott, if you remember, and I believe this is in 96, so a little after. Remember, there was a law that came down that said that some of the, like, for example, look at Time Warner. Remember, Time Warner had to release a certain amount of channels that they weren't using because it was a monopoly, which is, you know, that's why you had so many, there were so many people, so many black folk that tried to begin independent networks, you know, like Bounce and I believe Magic with Aspire. I think Magic had owned Aspire, but, you know, somebody had to let go of some of these channels. I think it was Time Warner. It was either Time Warner or Verizon. Excuse me. I don't want to mislead your listeners. But they got the government told them that they had to release some of the, you know, some of the airwaves.
You're correct, man. And I'm going to tell you something else, too, because I followed this. C-SPAN had it on. And Maxine Waters actually, when Comcast wanted to buy up part of NBC Universal, and you already know how these people go across platforms from music to having old archives and all of that. She pressured them into supposedly giving black minorities access to it. So what they've done is agreed to supposedly have six black minority platforms. But the agreement goes all the way to they have up until 2020 to do this. So what they've done is stretch out the negotiations to crowd out any black ownership of the entire platform. In other words, you have dedicated channels. You only can get in by doing negotiations with the people who already own the channel. This is why I argue with people that Oprah didn't selectively sell own. Oprah was in a 50-50 partnership with Discovery, and when she didn't produce to the level that the contract agreed to, they bought her out.
Hey, but Otis, I do want to say I got to interject ownership.
And not only that, when they bought her out, they gave her lawyer 10% ownership because she couldn't afford to pay him the fees. Hey, so but, I'm saying we have to wake up to what's going on with this.
Otis, I have to move on, bro, but I appreciate you. We got another call.
Thank you, brother Otis.
Area code 702, and we're up against it. Brother Doshon, we'll take this last call and then we'll let you give us your final assessment of what took place at the hearing today. But we have a call from 702. Give us your name. Go ahead with your question or comment. You're on with Doshon Farad, independent black media journalist.
Hello. Thank you for taking my call. This is Red in Nevada. All I wanted to ask Mr. Doshon, which is how can people get in contact with him? I definitely appreciate the commentary that he's given. So that's the only question I had. Thank you. I'll mute myself.
Oh, thank you, Sister Red. I can be reached. First of all, I'm on Facebook, and I have a I'm going to go through the list real quick, Brother Scotty. On Facebook, just to let you know, my name is spelled D as in David, O S-H-O-N as in Nancy. My last name is Farad, F as in Freedom, A-R-A-D. That's my name on Facebook as well as Twitter and Instagram. My webpage is my name, DashonFarad.page, P-A-G-E dot T-L. That's DashonFarad, one word, dot page, dot T-L. Also, you can look me up on YouTube. Type in my name and then the words right and exact. The and sign, the and symbol, right? And symbol, exact, because I have a YouTube video show. Yeah, I do one-on-one interviews and podcasts as well. My email address is, you can reach me at DashonFarad@gmail.com. But once again, I have a, Brother Scotty, I have a, you know, I have a podcast, but I'm also, my articles can be found at yourblackworld.net. Some of my articles were found, used to be found on news1.com, but that's another story, brother. You know, I kind of put them on blast yesterday for using my footage, but then trying to doubt my legitimacy as a journalist. That's another story. But anyway, just to read you, that's how you can reach me. But once again, on YouTube, you find my interviews and my stories because I shoot packages right and exact. That's right and the and symbol exact on YouTube. My name, and you'll see a lot of my stuff pops up, and my articles too pop up on the internet, but especially yourblackworld.net.
All right, Brother Doshon, we appreciate your work and service to the black community in the area of journalism. So if you could, in conclusion, for those who may have just tuned in, can you just give them a brief synopsis of what occurred in Philadelphia concerning Dr. Umar Johnson?
Well, Brother Scott, as a correction, it was Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, the capital. You know, Brother Umar with Dr. Johnson, he's from Philadelphia, but no, the hearing took place in Harrisburg, the state capital.
All right, thank
you. And once again, the hearing was to determine if whether or not he was fraudulently practicing clinical psychology. That's what it comes down to, because in most states, you need a license to practice clinical psychology. You know, a lot of folks are still commenting on my live streams. You know, you have some people that are the ones that are against them keep saying he shouldn't have lied about having a doctorate. They keep on going back to that. It was not to see whether or not he had a doctorate. Like I said, he has a doctorate. The two people that were, you know, the prosecutor and the woman overseeing the hearing kept calling him Dr. Johnson. Once again, it was to determine if whether or not he was illegally practicing clinical psychology. That's what it came down to. And if he's found guilty, then, you know, they'll charge him like maybe $10,000. And then he may not be able to apply for a license, or it may be difficult should he apply for a license to practice clinical psychology. That's what it came down to. And I just want to say, too, Brother Scott, like I said, once again, whether or not, you know, people keep on saying that, oh, you know, people don't know what they're talking about. They keep saying stuff on the Internet. Well, you know, they have the hearing. That's what he gets. You know, where's the money for the school? You know, that's what he gets for being a fraud. It was not about the school. That's another, like I said, and that's a legitimate concern. okay, concerning the school. That's legitimate, but we cannot allow emotions to, you know, to dictate, you know, our perception. That's not what the hearing was about. It had nothing to do with it. They didn't even bring up the school during the hearing. That's the funny thing about it. It was not about that.
Right.
That's, you know, that's another, you know, that's another type of hearing, another type of court case. It wasn't about that. They didn't bring up the school at all. I'm saying the prosecutor, he didn't bring up the school.
And that was put out on social media because I saw it come across Twitter. But thank you again, Brother Doshon. We got to move on because we got Brother Mark Clements who should be joining us here to talk about this death penalty case out of Texas concerning Rodney Reed, who is on death row. So I want to thank you again for your public service to the black community in the area of journalism. And you stay safe behind these enemy lines.
Thank you, Brother Scott. It's always a pleasure, my friend. And I wish you the same, brother. You know, please, you be safe as well, brother. You know, and straight ahead.
All right. Peace.
Peace.
You are tuned in to Black Talk Radio News. My name is Scotty Reed. I broadcast from behind these here enemy lines of USA Inc. every Tuesday night at 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time. We share music, news, information. We try to bring on as many guests as we can, and we hope to do more of that with Black Talk Radio News. But of course, I also host New Abolitionist Radio every Wednesday night with Brother Max Partis, and we were recently joined by a third co-host, Sister Layla, out there in California, Sister Layla Ali. So definitely check us out on Wednesday nights at the same time, 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time on Black Talk Radio Network, what the FBI might call BIE Radio. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after a couple of music tracks.
Your head and then turn around and accuse you of attacking them. Every case of police brutality against a Negro follows the same pattern. They attack you, bust you all upside your mouth, and then take you to court and charge you with assault. What kind of democracy is that? What kind of freedom is that? What kind of social or political system is it when a black man has no voice in court, has no nothing on his side other than what the white man chooses to give him? My brothers and sisters, we have to put a stop to this. And it will never be stopped until we stop it ourselves. They attack the victim. And then the criminal who attacked the victim accuses the victim of attacking him. This is American justice. This is American democracy.
You be scared. I ain't scared. I ain't scared. Because white folks love you when you're scared. There's only two kind of black people in America today. You either running free or you running scared.
Black murders, they the new slaves, we the new Nat Turners. No bodyguards, no entourage. We them sin kid niggas taking the Amistad bomber clock. We need to fast like Ramadan. The industry's a bunch of fake heroes like Comic Con. Behind that mask, you Robert Downey Jr. My Shiro's got a 2 million bounty on the future. Matulu's locked in San Bernardino County as a shooter. You some go along, get along, how we all neutered. I'm a upper thumb and trooper. My troop scars, you gon' need them to upper thumb suture.
Don't let these new Steven ass niggas recruit ya, cause with Miss Shaw Candy is tied, he gon' mute ya. And I ain't Django either, I ain't waiting for no white man to come and give me my freedom. I won't join him out, beat him, leave him rotten in the hot sun. Rock him with the shotgun, shot him, I'm the top one. Tell the coroner box him, eulogize then drop him. If the choice is freedom or death, then what's the option? Y'all them RG3 niggas, smiling at the camera, them happy that y'all can please niggas. I'm Barack Buffon's worth as a Marine nigga, deep like the mind of Farrakhan, I'm on my dean nigga. That's why I never believe niggas. Oh, you got the Instagrams, how come we never see pictures? Then claim God but never read scriptures, so we worship fame because a celebrity's richer. So Jesus becomes Jesus, then I guess Kim Kardashian is Mary Magdalene. And all her sins are cleansed through the camera lens. But then again, maybe I'm just rambling. Line up these industry CEOs and let me battle them. Show Jimmy Iovine the crime scene with his headless brethren, then tell him Chinese. And when I hear sirens, disconnect his neck from his spine clean. The difference, my spitting is the equivalent of using your high beams. All I want is you and your mind free. The time needs way more than a nice beat and a rhyme scheme. Cause all that bitch all that y'all talking don't fertilize seeds. I heard it takes two chains to make a slave. One on your physical frame and one on your brain. And once they got your mental enslaved, it runs like a train. So what are you really saying when you claim you stuck in the game? See, they create corporations cause they never wanted fame. So the nigga that you see is the nigga that's underpaid. Damn, just another slave. I'm John Jacques Dessalines. I swing him up with I'm Blade X.
Do you think that the white right wing is using the black militants to scale war against the black people in America?
Well, as I see it, the full-scale war against us has been going on for some 400 years.
I mean, completely, but, wipe us out, the black people out. I mean, that they can open the concentration camps, they can have justification of the backing off the black ghetto, wiring it off with troops around it. Do you think the right wing agitating the black panther or any other black militant group in that direction?
I don't really think that whether they're agitating or not, I won't say that they're not, but what they're putting themselves in for is quite a different thing, you see. In other words, as far as black people being slaughtered, we're slaughtered every day, and historically 50 million black people were killed on the Middle Passage alone, according to Melvin J. Herskovich, and this was an act of genocide, which is not talked about, and that the only thing people talk about is the plight of the Jews, where 6 million were killed, and when I state 50 million black people were killed, just bring them to this country, no one understands this. But what I'm saying is that our real danger is not the Burchites or the Minutemen or some other fanatics. That our danger is really the people who wear the uniform of the establishment, dressed in the clothes of the military or the police department. They're strong enough to wipe us out, not wipe us out. They're strong enough to inflict great harm upon the community. And this thing about the fanatics going around agitating, I don't think it will have a great consequence to the black community. The killing of little Bobby Hutton, our treasurer, was a matter of attempting to wipe out the leadership of the Panther, along with getting rid of Eldridge Cleaver because of his book, Soul on Ice, that reveals many things about the corruption of the penal system. Not only the Black Panther Party, black people in general are in danger. As you would note, that in the community where the police ambush the Panthers, that The police fired upon the community in general. They fired in people's homes where there might have been women and children. Matter of fact, I understand that a child was almost killed, and that it was a continuation of the traditional tactics, not only of the Oakland Police Department, but the police throughout the country. And an immediate end will have to be put to this, and I think that what's happening now is that the Black Panther Party is merely speeding up time. As we know that whenever a man becomes frantic and strikes wildly, that he's becoming very weak. He's striking now everyone in the world, and we know that he won't be able to engage the whole colored world into a war, and also fight a civil war here with the revolutionary people of America.
And welcome back to Black Talk Radio News. Scotty Reed in on this broadcast. Let me check the board and see if Mr. Clements have joined us. I just put a call out to him. So, Mr. Clements, if you are already on the line, just hit star to unmute yourself. Mr. Clements works with the campaign to end the death penalty. I first became acquainted with him probably about 4 or 5 years ago in the early days of Black Talk Radio Network, and found his story to be quite appalling. And I tell you, in a system of slavery, people think about the horrors that went on back in the, you know, several generations ago, like 3 or 4 generations ago. Those horrors haven't quit. They occur daily in these jails, in these prisons, on these streets. And I just don't understand why people, a lot of people, can't see it except for the programming. You got Steven Spielberg making movies telling you slavery was abolished. You got holidays reinforcing that and celebrations and traditions. All due respect, that's why I don't celebrate, Juneteenth, because that's a celebration of a lie. Juneteenth is based around Texas. Man, we've been in Texas tonight, and Mr. Rodney Reed, his case is in Texas, but 2 years after African descendant people finally got their quote-unquote freedom, not yet knowing or fully comprehending the trick of the 13th Amendment to start prison slavery, but in Texas, they got the news 2 years late, and that's why people now celebrate Juneteenth, because they got the news in June. I think it was 2 years after, maybe June 1867 or 68. But it reinforces a lot. But again, I don't argue people. I don't go on social media when people saying happy Juneteenth. I don't go on their thread saying you ain't got nothing to be happy about. They still practicing slavery. I don't try to be the Scrooge of Juneteenth or nothing like that. You know, when I have an opportunity to have private conversations, or maybe they might tune in to my radio program and they might hear me. But I don't go around playing bar humbug on people's celebrations, whether we talking about Christmas, Kwanzaa. I leave people to that. I'm focused on getting freedom. How are we going to end slavery? Okay, so let me check the board. I do not see Mr. Clements on the board, and we have about 15 minutes. So how about this? How about I just tell you about Rodney Reed? Again, I covered this case before, maybe 2 years ago. It's been a while since I've had an update, but you know these cases can languish for years with no movement, and the system still practicing slavery. So this man, Rodney Reed, again, as I stated, was convicted of killing and murdering Stacy Stites, 19 years old. Now, if I remember correctly, and I wish Mr. Clements was here to correct me if I'm wrong, but I got a pretty good memory when it comes to these things. That's why my sister would be so angry with me, because she was like, he don't never study. Well, I study. I just read what I need to read, and I can just recall it like that. And I do recall that there was some question of Mr. Reed perhaps engaging in a sexual relationship with Miss Stites, and she had a boyfriend, this slave catcher by the name of Jimmy Fennell, at the time of her murder. And again, as I stated, legal experts say they believe that Reed was framed and is innocent of murdering the young woman. This occurred in 1996. So he's been sitting on death row. He has always maintained his innocence. And we know a lot of innocent people are on death row. The work of people like Mark Clements, the campaign to end the death penalty, the Innocence Project out there. It seems like, don't quote me, but we got at least 100 people being released every year. That's just far too many people. And I'm with Mr. Clements in the campaign to end the death penalty. I don't want Dylan Root to be put to death. I want him to be segregated away from whatever you want to call it, prison. I'm not about abolishing prisons, y'all. People try to confuse the abolitionist movement with prison abolition. I'm about abolishing slavery. Because we do have people who commit heinous crimes, as alleged that Jimmy Fennell did, and then they framed Mr. Reed for this crime. So he's been fighting to have a new evidence hearing, and there was a judge who oversaw an October hearing of new evidence in his case, and he made a recommendation to the Court of Criminal Appeals against Reed getting a new trial. And this is according to Reed's defense attorney. Now, there was a visiting judge by the name of Doug Shavers who recommended a decision in favor of the state is an obstacle for Reed's defense. So the state is arguing, no, there's no new evidence. We don't need, hey, we sure that this is an airtight case. Mr. Reed's attorney is saying there's new evidence to suggest that you had the wrong man, and then we should have a new hearing based on this evidence. So it appears that you have another judge in this process who looked at that and decided in favor. But I'm kind of confused about this case because Dennis is saying that an appeals court will make the ultimate decision. So what's going on here? That's kind of confusing to me. Why do you need a visiting judge, Doug Shaver, who's going to recommend? So he's making a recommendation to the appeals court? Is that how I should read that and understand that? That they not give Reed a new trial? Is he like been some kind of arbitrator or something? So definitely we're looking forward to getting updates on this. This is a setback. But Mr. Reed, although I'm sure emotionally and mentally devastated, decades on death row, but I'm sure he hasn't given up. So you can check out more information. I have linked to this in btrcommunity.com. Again, we have to support independent media. So as we get ready to close out the show, independent media costs money. And if you don't have corporate backers, if you don't have like Coca-Cola and all these other people that's spending big money to advertise on your media, then how are you supposed to produce media? How are you supposed to maintain digital media platforms, whether we're talking about radio, video, podcasting, live radio streams? How can you maintain an independent network like that unless you're a nonprofit like the Black Talk Media Project and not trying to reinvent the wheel, but your goal is to duplicate national public radio, but from a Black perspective, and just getting progressive platforms out there to localize our media. The problem, as we were having a conversation with Mr. Farad, is that while he says we need a bunch of Black TV shows, these are still corporate networks. We don't own these networks. And especially their news divisions have shown to not be so ethical that they don't push state propaganda or give in to special interest groups and censor the news and what have you. Again, Roland Martin spoke to Black issues, but he wasn't getting deep down in there like calling it slavery and stuff like that. And so again, you have that leash on you when you're dependent upon corporations to pay the bills. So this is People Power Radio. NPR says it gets 80 something percent of its donations from the people. I know they get tens of millions from U.S. government grants. It was started by the United States government and what have you. And I just, you know, some people say, sadly, that, hey, NPR is about the only straightforward news that's out there that's giving it to you. But that's still a government propaganda operation. Black Talk Media Project is not under the influence of the U.S. government or the corporations. And so we encourage people to become members in a secure social media environment by joining btrcommunity.com. $24 a year. That goes towards funding our operations. And we're trying to come up with an annual budget of $120,000. I did the math the other day. I think that's like 5,000 members of BTR Community on a $24 a year subscription. That would not only allow us to maintain Black Talk Radio Network and make some needed improvements to the experience, but also allow us to create a physical radio station starting right here in Gaston County as the model for what we want to duplicate all across the United States. We have to localize our radio. We can't be dependent on a few nationalized voices when all politics is local, as they say. All revolution starts locally. All change is going to start from the bottom up, not the top down. That's what it's all about when they promote people to you for CEO of USA Inc., like Oprah Winfrey, whose name was mentioned as being a serious presidential contender for 2020. Nothing against Miss Oprah Winfrey, but I don't know what her politics is like. Okay? And we should not expect change to come from the top down, but from the bottom up. That means we have to be the change. So we need to change up the programming. We need to expand revolutionary programming that promotes critical thinking to the masses. Make no mistake, Malcolm X was correct that media does control the minds of the masses. So yes, we are in effect asking donors to help us to control people's minds. That's just the science of the technology. So as I conversated, well, if the enemy is using this mind control device on the people, we will be idiots not to produce our own counter mind programming. But we want to program people with truth and justice, not propaganda in support of the oppression of people worldwide. This is truly People Power Public Radio, and we hope that you will support it by becoming a member of btrcommunity.com. Again, that's $24 a year subscription. We're aiming for a budget of $120,000. That's $120,000 for a school, not just a radio station now, but an actual media center so we can teach the generations. Okay, generations from our 16-year-olds to our college students to people my age in their 50s. Anybody who's willing to learn and to be that voice on those local digital airways and platforms that the Black Talk Media Project wants to create. So that's 5,000 members. That's our membership drive, our goal. 5,000 members of BTRCommunity.com or you can become a business sponsor. If I'm not mistaken, I think if we had 120 business sponsors, doesn't NPR take business sponsors? Don't they have a little announcement about the Arthur T., whatever, Viney Corporation or the Ford Foundation provided this grant so that you can listen to this public radio? So we want to offer business sponsorships out there where you can get a visual logo of your business on our website, blacktalkradionetwork.com, on blacktalkmediaproject.org for just $1,000 a year. That's less than $100 a month. Not only will you have that banner advertisement with a link to your business as a business sponsor of Public Black Radio and media, but you will also get a audio ad, and we will help promote your business. We'll share it on our social media network. So if we just got 120 of those business sponsors at $1,000 a year, that will really help us take a giant leap forward in trying this thing in this incubator and controlling the minds of the masses towards revolution, towards freedom, towards the end of slavery, as opposed to, hey, we can just keep letting them continue to take over the FCC license airways and not take advantage of the open internet in producing our platforms and localizing them. All right. Thank you to our guest tonight for joining us. Sister Kilaika joined us to talk about the brother with the Guerrilla Mainframe. We'll definitely do some follow-up on that. We heard from Doshon Farad, and unfortunately, we were not able to hook up with Mr. Mark Clements, but we'll see him on the other side, and he can come back on. He know the door is always open to him. All right, recognize the fact that we live behind the enemy lines of USA, Inc., and understand also that they have many partners globally, all over the planet, in Asian countries and African countries. They pay a lot of money to these people to oppress their own people and to implement U.S. policy, not policies that's for the indigenous people, the citizens of those nations, but policies that's going to benefit the corporate paymasters of the politicians, who then implement that corporate policy through U.S. foreign policy. So the war is indeed global, and we need to recognize this. And we need to be serious about coming up with ways to combat it, because it's not going to end itself. Why would it? Why would you stand slavery if it's profitable? And you can fool the people into thinking that you stop, but at the same time, you're raking in billions, trillions, even if we want to look at it globally. Legally, not the illegal kind, but legally, do this. Come on, people, it's time to wake up. And as Max Partis would say, rise up against this 21st century slavery and human trafficking. Stay tuned to blacktalkradionetwork.com. Of course, I'll be uploading reports, little news snippets throughout the week. Tomorrow is Wednesday, so that's a busy day of broadcasting. You got Tanya Free and Friends coming on at 2 o'clock p.m. Eastern. Then we got Tando Radio Show at 6, New Abolitionist Radio at 8, and then closing out the night is the ladies on Mind, Body, and Spirit. Peace and blessings to all y'all. Be safe out there.